on network attacks and botnets. First, we will go through network attacks, then we will see botnets. First of all, what is an attack? So, it is a set of malicious activity to disrupt, deny, disagree, or destroy information and service resident in computer networks. What are the things? If any activity or any malicious activities, any activity that disrupt, deny, disagree, or destroy information and service resident in computer networks, then we'll call that activity is an attack. Understand? So there is an OSI develop the model, or we theoretically think the model is having, the communication model is having 7 layers, okay? And out of the 7 layers, 2 layers can be understood by any people, whoever is using the internet, an engineer can understand that these 2 layers are the first layer, that is application layer, and that last one, that is called physical layer. Okay, so in some places we will find the physical layer is given as first layer, and application layer is given as 7th layer. So it depends, from which end you are looking at this stack. So application layer means that layer where through which we are accessing internet, like our internet browser, they are the application layer. Not only Chrome and all, any application which is using internet, that is the application working on the application layer, right? And physical layer means all the devices, cables, and that what kind of cable, FO cable, or fiber optic cable, or optical fiber cable, or fiber optic cable, FO cable. Then you have the other, twisted pair cable, then your RJ45 port. Then Cat5, all these things are there. Then also we will find that access points. Then switches, router, all these things are whatever physically you can see are belongs to the physical layer. Even these access point, switch, and routers, they can have multiple layer. They may have 3 layers inside these devices, like last 3 layers. Okay, but as they're physically, you can see and you can change, configure. So they are treated are in physical layer. Most importantly, these port and cables are physical layer. They are only belongs to physical layers. Okay, so. Before I discuss with this intermediate 5 layers, I should discuss about these 2 layers first. Okay. So when you are an application layer, so what kind of attack can happen on application layer? It can be some kind of exploitation. That means, that application may run some malicious code in the background and do some exploits. Or it can be something like somebody have collected some user ID and password maliciously or illegally and accessing their account. So all these things are happening, can happen in the application layer. On the other hand, when you are in the physical layer, that means you have access to the hardware only, like these cables and ports. So what kind of thing can happen? You can only do one thing, that is tapping. We call here it is snipping. You can only see what communications are happening. Okay. So the sniffing, one kind of sniffing is called surveillance sniffing. Okay. All other kind of attacks happens in the these five layers. Okay, so in this intermediate five layers, first you will find data link layer. So in data link layer, what kind of thing can happen? It can happen spoofing, like, you know, what kind of spoofing? MAC or ARP sniffing again. No, so MAC address or ARP packets, all these things can be sniffed in the data link layer if somebody is doing the attack on the data link layer. Okay. Then network layer, what kind of things happens? Mainly happens the man in the middle attack. So many times we speak about, you know, eavesdroppers or something who can, you know, collect your packet from the network. So they basically works in the network layer. What kind of things can happen here? An attack can happen IP or port scanning. Then comes transport layer. So reconnaissance, like, you know, TCP session snipping and UDP snipping happens in this transport layer. Then comes session layer. Session layer, this by this term we all are familiar with it, like, you know, many times you will find when you are using online banking system or other secure website, you know, if you don't active for a long time on these websites, you will get a message that your session is over. So how this session gets over? Because this session layer maintains the session, and when you, you know, start using the connection, it start with a time limit, and every time you, you know, keep using it, that time limits gets changes. Okay, you get you know, the increment of that time limit, but when you stop using your activity, that session time is going to be, you know, finish after some time, and it is going to, you know, end the session. But in the meantime, what kind of attack can happen? Hijacking. Hijacking means what kind of hijacking? Session hijacking means whatever you are doing on your browser, that same thing can happen parallelly on some other browser. Okay, by hijacking your session, or some other communication can happen using your established session. Right? So telnet and FTP sniffing can happen here. And in presentation layer, the phishing things happens, like SSL and TSL sniffing also happens in presentation layer. So these are the seven layers of OSI, OSI model, we call it OSI model. So seven layers of OSI model, and what kind of attack happens in what kind of layers. So I just do one thing, sorry. And under each of the session, I just underline them with different ink, so that you can easily remember that what is the main thing happens or main attacks happens in which layer. So this under blue underlined things are the main attacks happens in the corresponding OSI layers. Okay. It's a probe. So you may have heard this term many times in legal perspective, like carrying out probe against this organization, this person, all these things happens. Because the same thing, probe is nothing but, if you see the dictionary, meaning of probe is basically carrying out investigation. Okay, so probes are scanning computer networks to gather information or find known vulnerabilities. So the scanning of computer information are basically what? It is going to investigate. This investigation is done by whom? By attacker. So attacker does investigation to find, gather information or find known vulnerabilities in the system, is known as probe, right? So what kind of probes are there? IP sweep and port sweep is one kind of probe. Then what happens in IP sweep and port sweep are determine the running host and its service type in the network. Okay, so by this IP sweep and port sweep, the attacker just collect the information that which are the ports are running, which are, and what are the IP addresses are activated, are active. Okay. And through this IP address and those ports, what kind of services are available? Okay. Next, this is a tool called Nmap. Okay. So it Nmap you can install also on your system. Okay, for good purpose definitely. Okay, you can see the IP scan. That means in the net in your network, you know, which IPs are active at that time, which are actively communicating. It can give you port scan, that means on which IP, which ports are activated. Then firewall scan that in the network, whether there is some firewall or not. Okay. Then OS fingerprinting, that means corresponding to each IP, it will show you which operating system that user is using and their version and all. Okay. Then mscan is another tool that complete range of IP address, it you know, it will collect from a network and display. Then same another tool which can show the finger, that means what user is typing. Then FTP, telnet, TFTP, NIS, NFS, and all these services, whether these services are activated or not activated, it can, this information can be used by using this same tool. Then Shatan is another tool that works in the same way like Saint. Okay. Then there is two other things called privilege escalation or privilege escalation attack. What are these two things? What kind of privilege escalation happens? One is vertical privilege escalation, another is horizontal privilege escalation. The vertical privilege escalation means it escalates vertically. So vertically means you can understand vertically on the hierarchy, right? So in the hierarchy at the top, there is some admin, or at the bottom, there is what? End users. Right. So say the attacker got the credential of an end user. So using this end user's account, the attacker will just log in to the network or to the servers and try to do malicious thing to get more privileges, okay, or more access on the network. And it will just more access means it is going towards admin. It finally admin on, we call the root, root access. So it even try to get the root access, and if it gets the root access finally, then it can do anything on the system, okay. And horizontal escalation is, first user's detail they have collected, then the next user's detail it will collect. Okay, so it's the non-user to user. Okay, so a normal user with ordinary account or without any account on a system exploits some vulnerability in the system in order to access function or content reserved for other normal user. So understand. So. Say that there is an attacker here. Okay. So this attacker tries to get access to a normal user's account detail, and that is called what? Horizontal escalation. Okay, and from this account to this another account, so it is happening horizontally. Okay. Then privilege escalation attack. So it happens in different way, like using buffer overflow attack, then misconfiguration attacks, race condition attacks, and man in the middle attacks. Now, here are some of the topics and detail here you need to know. So, social and phishing attacks are there, which target and purpose is pre-attack intelligence recon, build trust using fake social profiles, and initial infection. Right. So using social and phishing attack, the attacker can do all these things. Then you can see malware and zero-day and botnet attacks. So what is the target for this? targets are like endpoint system and the server, and purpose is obtain access to the system, create backdoors, you know, establish command and control over large network or devices. Right. Then comes the password and configs. The target is endpoint system and the server, and purpose is initial penetration, expansion of risk, and escalation of privileges. Next is distributed denial of service attack. So we have already many times spoken a little bit on denial of service attack, right? The targets are like a network and application infrastructure, and purpose are like cause operational disruption and create diversion for other attacks. Next is smart and mobile hacking. Target is mobile and embedded systems or services, and purpose is give attack surface and entry point to enterprise networks and gain access to user data through vulnerable mobile operating system and apps. And final one is, you can see, SQL injection. So target of SQL injections are basically the database servers, and purpose of this kind of an injection is obtain access, account and user credentials, right? So all these things you can see, you know, obtain account and user credentials, all these things are usually served in some database on the server. So using the SQL injection to the database server, they try to get access to all these things, okay? Or stale sensitive data, even, you know, in database there is many sensitive data of your organization, so all this data can be stolen. Then there is a type of a different kind of malwares. First one is a bug, so a type of error, flow, or failure that produce an undesirable or unexpected result. So bugs typically exist in a website source code and can cause a wide range of damage to the system. Okay, next comes is virus. Virus, you already know what is it. It is a piece of code that is loaded onto your, you know, website or computer without your knowledge. It can easily multiply and be transmitted as an attachment of or file. Next comes Trojan horse. What is this? It is much like the myth. So the story of Trojan, I think all of you know. So a Trojan disguises itself as a normal file and, you know, tricks users into downloading it and consequently installing the malwares. Finally comes next comes is the adware. So it is type of malware that automatically displays unwanted advertisements. Clicking on one of these ads could redirect you to a malicious website. Okay. Then comes worms. So a worm relies on security failures to replace and spread itself to other computers. They are often hidden in attachments and will consume bandwidth and overload the web servers. Next is the bots. So it is a software program creates to perform specific tasks. Bot can send spam or be used in a DOS attack to bring down an entire website. And next is ransomware. Ransomware is a quite common thing, we all heard about this. So ransomware denies access to your file and demands payment, right? So through Bitcoin, in order to access to the granted again. So it will grant you access again, but in exchange of some kind of payment or Bitcoin and all, okay? Spyware is another thing. It is a type of malware that functions by spying on a user activity. So it spy the user's activity. Okay, this type of spying includes monitoring a user's activity, keystroke, and more. Okay, now example of DOS and distributed DOS attacks. So denial of service is DOS, and distributed denial of service is DDoS. Right. So TCP sync and flood attack, then ICMP, UDP flood attack, then ping of death attack, then smart attack. I'm not going into detail of these things because, you know, for this thing again, we have to discuss about the TCP protocol, then what is sync in TCP, then ICMP protocol, why it is used, and UDP protocol. These are different protocol, right? So we need to discussing and then what happens in ping first. So I'm not going into all networking part and networking protocol right now. So I'm just not telling you the detail of all these things. Okay. So example of well-known worms attacks are like cluster, you know, Windows 2000 operating system in August 2003. Then Nachi is another one in August 2003. The outbreak of Nachi infected the ATM machines. And then Slammer is another, you know, appeared in January 2003, infected 75,000 victims in just 10 minutes. Routing attacks here are mainly based on DOS attack. Okay, so open short path or OSPF protocol and sequence increasing seconds plus maximum is okay, maximum sequence number. So, you know, I'm not you may not know all these things. If you read the networking in detail, so you will find that the network packets packets means so what you know carries your message. So your messages are, you know, transmits in some envelope called packet here. Okay, so network packets are having their sequence number, their maximum age, that means how long these packets can, you know, stay on the network. You know, many times you will find that when you are sending a SMS, if your SMS is not going to be delivered immediately, it will wait for, I think, 48 hours. After that only, you will get a message from the operator that your SMS was not able, you was not able to deliver your SMS, and it is deleted or something, right? So the network keeps any packet or any message for a certain time, that is called maximum age of that packet. Okay, and maximum sequence number. So this sequence number also having a limit for every communication. So this maximum sequence number is also matters. So all these things can be manipulated by the attacker, and they can launch some kind of routing attack. Then broader gateway protocol is another protocol in networking. Based on that, exploiting that protocol, also some attacks happen. So I'm not going into this, you know, depth of all these things because it will just increase confusion for you. Okay, next is botnets. So what is botnets? First, we need to know what is bot, right? So a malware instance that runs automatically on a compromised computer. It runs autonomously and automatically on a compromised computer. Once this computer is you know, compromised by a bot, we call that computer as a zombie. Okay, so without owner's consent, it happens that there is computer and it is infected by some bot without the owner's consent. Who is the owner of the computer? He does not know that this bot is there in the computer. Bot is a malicious software, okay, or malware. Then we will call this as a zombie. Okay. And then it can be profit-driven, professionally written, and widely propagated. And you might have seen them before in chat room, online games, etc. So you may have seen these kind of bots in chat room and other places in online games and all. Okay. Then what is a botnet? So that means bot. So like this here, I've shown one computer. This computer is compromised by this bot. If there is many computers like this, and the network of all these compromised computers will be called as botnet. Okay, so network of bots controlled by criminals. Definition: a coordinated group of malware instances that are controlled by a bot master via some command and control channel. Okay, so there will be some bot master. Okay, but basically criminals. Controls zombies or botnet. Controls the botnets using command and control. Using command and control technique. So this is the relation between bot master, bot net, and command and control. Okay. So these bot nets are basically network of, you can say, compromised PCs or different kind of bot nets. One is in a centralized, and here you can see distributed, and it's kind of peer-to-peer connection. And in this centralized one, you can see the command and control system is here at the center, and all the boards are connected to it. Okay, and here you can see when it is distributed, the each board is connected to all other boards, or you can say several boards. Okay, so this is you can understand that. More dangerous kind of framework, because every boat is can control or communicate with other boats. Okay, so the boat master need to just give instruction to one of the boat, automatically that instruction is going to be propagated to all the boats. But it is kind of single point command and control in case of in a centralized architecture. So the boat master gives instruction to the command and control system, and this system sends the instruction to all the ports. Okay. Then break. So numerous versions of botnets are available. According to a study in 2013 by Encapsula, more than 61% of all the web traffic is now generated by bots. Okay, and 25% of internet PCs are part of botnet. Okay. So these are two survey, quite old. Even that is significant, but and it's definitely a real threat. So what is command and control channel? The command and control channel is needed so bot can receive their commands and coordinate fraudulent activities. The command and control channel is the mean by which individual bots form a botnet. So you can understand what is command and control channel. Now, America's 10 most wanted botnets are listed here. You can see here GS, that is 3.6 million pieces are infected by this. And like this, you can see many. Okay. And you can click on this link, sources. Just go here. You will find all the detail of these botnets. Yeah. Here you can see detail of all these things. So I'm just not going to discuss each of them. If you want, if you can, you can go this, go to this website, and you can see detail of these botnets. Okay. So next, what are they used for? They can be used for denial of service attack, spreading the spams, doing some phishing attack, information theft, distributing other malware using the botnet. Okay. Then botnet detection is hard. Why? Because 1 out of 4 pieces are infected. So bots are stealthy of infected machines and bots. Botnets are dynamically evolving and becoming more flexible. Static and signature-based approaches are less effective on botnet. Coming many versions, you can say that it is having only one particular architecture. So it have many architectures, like centralized distributed, centralized architecture, distributed architecture, and different channel, etc. There, there is no one size fits for all solution. You know, for botnets. Then, existing techniques not effective, like you know, antivirus. The tools need to be upgraded frequently, and both uses rootkit. So antiviruses are not always effective. The intrusion detection system do not have the big picture of it. You know, yeah, but it is an old statement. But nowadays, intrusion detection system become quite you know an improved and mature thing. Then past research aim. Are too specific, like you know, some apply to specific type of botnet, like you know, IRC based only or centralized only, and some apply specific instances of botnets. So bot miners are there again. So observations are bots part of botnet have similar communications. How we can you know mine the bots? So when we find that you know many. And boats are behaving in the same way. Then we can assume that you know these all these faces are doing some kind of communication. That means maybe they are you know forming a botnet, and all these faces are compromised with some boats. Then the boats part of botnet takes similar action. Then boats stay there for a long term. Personally, like let's find the machines that have. Correlated or similar communication and action over time. Okay. So how to be secure? There you can see the 10 steps to cyber security. One is a network security. Protect your network against you know, external and internal attack. Then is a network perimeter filter and. Filter out unauthorized access and malicious content, and monitor and test the security control. Then comes the malware prevention, produce the relevant policy and establish anti-malware defense that are applicable and relevant to all business areas. Scan for malware across the organization. Then is monitoring. We need to monitor, you know, the network and pieces. Establish a monitoring strategy and develop supporting policies and continuously monitor all ICT system and networks. Okay, analysis log for unusual activity that could indicate an attack. Then incident management. So establish an incident response and disaster recovery. Capability, produce the and test incident management plans, provide specialist training to the incident management team, and report criminal incident to law and enforcement. Then user education and awareness is very, very important to reduce user security policy and covering acceptable and secure use of the organization's systems, establish a staff training program, maintain user awareness you know, on cyber risk. Then home and mobile working. Develop a mobile working policy and train staff to adhere with it. So like you know, nowadays in the pandemic time, the home and mobile working is very much popular and people are working from home. So it is very important nowadays. Okay, apply the secure baseline built to all the devices and protect data both in the you know, transit and at rest. At rest means when your data is on the you know, server or where in storage. Then secure configuration is another important thing. Apply secure patches and ensure that the secure configuration of all, you know, ICT, that means information and communication technology system, is maintained and create a system inventory and define baseline and build for all ICT devices. So what is this, you know, define a baseline? That means the minimum amount of security everybody have to maintain in all the related devices. That is called baseline. Okay. Then removable media controls, right? Produce a policy to control all access to removable media, limit media types and use. Scan all media for malware before importing into corporate system. Then managing user privileges is another important thing. Establish account management process and limit the number of privileged account, then limit user privileges and monitor user activity, control access to activity and audit logs. Okay. Next thing, we can have firewalls. We can install firewalls, like you can see here, internet and here intranet. So what is intranet? Intranet is your LAN or what is in your office. Okay, and this is internet. You understand what is internet. So all this, this part is basically the property of this office, okay, or you can say some corporate enterprise. So what is this listed here? Put a firewall here and put another firewall here. This firewall will protect your data, web server, database server, everything, whatever you have, from the external attacks. And this firewall will protect all these things from the internal attacks. So, and this middle, this zone is called DMZ, demilitarized zone. Okay, what are the things are kept here? You can see web server, email server, web proxy, and everything, you know, put here. So that neither from neither side, it, some immediate attack can happen, because both the side you have firewalls to protect. Okay, then why firewall? It is used to filter packet based on combination of features. What kind of feature it checks? These are called packet filtering firewalls. So there are other types too, but they will not be discussed here. Okay. So there is mainly packet filtering firewalls are very effective, because they analyze each packet, goes through it, and drop the packets if the firewall feels that it is malicious. It can be malicious. The drop packet which destination port 23, and that is telnet. Now say you don't need telnet in your system, in your network, in the, if you see here, in this area, you don't need a telnet request from the outsider. Okay, then on this firewall, you just block telnet. Okay, that is what? User port 23 is dedicated for telnet services. So you just block port 23. Okay, so can you use any combination of IP, UDP, TCP header information for blocking? Okay, then there is manual of IPFW on Unix 47. For much more detail, you can go and see. Then, but why don't we just turn telnet off? So why not we off the telnet totally, instead of dropping the packets which are targeting to 423, or which are targeting to get telnet access? So there is a different reasons. We are not going into that. Okay. Then here is what computer with default Windows XP install looks like. So I'm not going into this also, because we are not using Windows XP anymore. So just go ahead. Next is, you can say, intrusion detection systems. So used to monitor for suspicious activity on a network, can protect against known software exploits like buffer overflows, right? So open source IDS systems are available, like smart, one of them, smart.org. Then intrusion detection uses intrusion signature. Okay. It can use some other thing also, but this is one of the way of doing it, how intrusion detection systems works. So well-known patterns of behavior that,